So let's start session two, the desecration of worship. Now, let's just go to the former eternity and then the angelic period. God made the angels, and in heaven, before the world began, the angels of God were worshipping God. And one particular worship session, all the angels were bowing and worshipping God. Now, in heaven, worship is very sacred. We know the angels say, "God, you are holy." This morning we said those words, didn't we? I don't know how many of us, we were really saying it like the angels do. But the angels were worshipping, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord." When they were worshipping, suddenly one day, or one moment, there was no day, an angel just stopped for a moment. He stopped worshipping and instead started watching the object of worship. Who was that? God. He looked at God. Then he looked at the other angels. And for a moment he wondered, what would it be like if, you know, if I could get some of that? How many of you have seen a preacher preaching and the congregation spellbound and wish you could capture the audience's attention like that? I used to do that as a believer. I wish I could also. That is, I want some attention. I want some glory. I want people to admire me. That is the first sin ever. That brought the downfall of the angels. And immediately the angels were cast into hell. But from hell, all these angels have sworn, "We have lost heaven's glory." In Paradise Lost, John Milton, he writes, he says, after he was cast into hell, the devil said, "I prefer to be here because better is it to rule in hell than serve in heaven. Let me rule here." And he said, "God, I have lost the glory of heaven, but I will do everything to prevent you from getting that glory." Who is supposed to be giving God the glory? You and I. And he will do anything to prevent us from giving God the glory. So session two is all about, how does the devil prevent us from giving God the glory? Through many years of experience, Satan has finally come to the best and the most successful method. He has combined two things that cannot be combined, like fire and water and day and night. This Satan has combined two things that should never be combined, and that is worship. Worship is something very holy, very sacred. He has combined worship and entertainment. The combination of worship and entertainment can never be. Yet this combination has come to pass, and we see through this, he has destroyed the whole thing of worship. Now, I want to take you some more into this. Do you know the meaning of entertainment? The root, the meaning of entertainment means diversion. A diversion. Entertainment. Now, guests are normally entertained after a meal to divert them from the monotony of the evening. So, entertainment means diversion. It's just meant to make the people happy. Now, entertainment. Now the world is full of entertainment. Entertainment has become a drug. Do you believe that? Yes, this world has become entertainment crazy. 24 hours of non-stop entertainment. And if you want to challenge this, I challenge you to live 2 days without any form of entertainment, without any form of relaxation. You see, man is having entertainment piped to him through all his senses. He's got the television, the internet, the magazines and films all for his eyes. He's got music and his mobile phone for his ears. He's got perfumes for his nose. He's got food for his taste. He's got pleasures of comfort for his feeling. So let me see. Live without all this for 2 days. Can you live without your mobile phone for 2 days? Can you live without the internet, without magazines, without films? Well, for your eyes. And then music for the ears. Perfumes for the nose. And food. Eat food, but don't eat tasty food. and then pleasures of comfort for the feelings. Now, the entertainment addict, he wants to be entertained all the time. He will be entertained while his hair is being cut. He will be entertained while his car is being serviced. He will be entertained while he's driving to work. He will be entertained while he's driving to the post office round the corner. He will be entertained on his way back. He will be entertained when he's going to bed. He'll be entertained when he's getting up from bed. He'll be entertained right through the day, and then he wants a holiday. So this is the entertainment addict. All the time, entertainment, entertainment, entertainment. I heard recently that there was entertainment during a funeral service. I'm not sure how many of you heard about that. So entertainment, entertainment. The whole world is now entertainment crazy. All the time people want to have fun. Entertainment, diversion. Now that's become the main thing. This is all the plan of Satan. What has he brought that entertainment to? Now he's adding poison to it. Where it was just TV and internet, now violence and pornography on the TV and the internet for the eyes. Where it was just music, he has introduced behavior-altering music for the ears. Where it was just perfumes, now sensuous smells and drug sniffing for the nose. And where it was just food earlier, drugs and alcohol for the mouth. And where it was pleasures of comfort, pleasures of sin have taken over for the feelings. Everywhere, now man is ruled by the spirit of entertainment. He can't live without entertainment. He can't be without having fun. That's the spirit of the world. And I want to tell you about the influence of humanism. Humanism, humanistic teachings are a few. The basic of these, now the whole world, without the knowledge of your knowledge or their knowledge, the whole world is living by the tenets of humanism. Now, what is this humanism? Humanism has five tenets. I will tell you three of them. First of all, atheism. Atheism means there's no God you need to fear. So you can sin without the fear of being accountable. Now, something that guides us is we can't sin easily. Now, for example, you lose your temper, instantly you feel guilty. Why? You know there's a God watching you. The moment that God watching you is not there, you don't feel guilty anymore. So there is no fear of accountability. So instead of God being there, humanism teaches that you are your own God. So now who is God? You are God. And another thing they teach us is amorality. Now what is that? Amorality is there is nothing like right or wrong. You decide what is right and you decide what is wrong. No one can tell you what is right or wrong. You are your own master. Thirdly, autonomy. That is, you run your life. You are the center of your life. Your life revolves around you and your happiness. You, 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 you. Can you see what the whole world is driving you to? You, 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 not God. You have become the center and God is no longer the center. So when you become the center, everything is coming towards you. Everything comes to a now. You say, take the center of a circle. Take a cake being cut. Every time the knife goes through, it goes towards the center. Towards the center, towards the center. You have become the center of your world and everything is for you now. My happiness, I must be happy. No, even in a family situation, the husband makes himself the center and the wife makes herself the center. I must be happy. And Satan encourages this. So you, 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 everywhere in the world. Now that demon entertainment, after having spoiled the whole world, has finally begun to knock at the door of the church. How did he do that? You know, earlier, what was church? Have you ever heard this phrase? Church is church. There was a time when church was church. Young people and old people all knew church was a holy place. Church was a place for serious people. Church was a place where God met men. Church was a place where you drop your sin out and walk in. They knew that They could not bring their unclean lives into church. They were afraid of church. Lower than he actually is, your worship will be lower than what it should be. The Bible says, because the people did not glorify him as God should be glorified, what happened to the people? They don't have victory in their thoughts, and they had lusts in their heart. A person who does not give God the glory and the worship that he should be given the way he should be given, but gives it the way he wants to give. Some people, they glorify God with their heart. Some people, they just say it for the sake of it. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. If you don't give God the worship that is due to him, we become vain in our imaginations, and our foolish heart is darkened, says the Bible. We find in the Bible, all those who thought about God or spoke about God, they were always aware of the greatness of God, the holiness of God, and God was God. But now we see in today's world, people have humanized God, deified man. Humanized God means making God a man. Then they have deified man, that is making man a God, and they have minimized sin, making sin less serious than what it actually is. And today many know God only for what he does. Nobody knows God for who he is. I want to tell you, the re-imaged God is whom many, I won't say many of us, but many Christians are worshipping the re-imaged God, not the original God in the Bible. Many of us, I dare say, may not be worshipping the God of the Bible. Who is this re-imaged God? Satan has changed our view of the real God. This re-imaged God is a bit different now. First of all, this re-imaged God, he loves to share his glory. He loves to give a little of his glory to you and to other gods. Whereas in the Bible, what do we read in Isaiah 42 verse 8? Someone, Isaiah chapter 42 verse 8. This is the real God of the Bible, the living God. Of what does he say? Isaiah 42, 8.
I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another.
I am the Lord, and my glory will I not give. My glory will I not give to another. But the new God, the re-imaged God, he's a little kinder. He's a little more generous, more understanding. What does he do? He won't keep all the glory for himself. A little glory he allows the preachers to have. A little glory the singers can have. And some glory for the musicians. And so now everybody wants to share the glory of God. He permits lesser gods to share his throne. This is the re-imaged God, but this is not the God of the Bible. Also, the new God, the re-imaged God of the Christians, he is more tolerant. Now, tolerance, you hear that word outside. Religious tolerance. You must tolerate other religions and other people, their sentiments. It's a good word, but abused. Now, the new God, the re-imaged God, he's very tolerant of sin. So many people are committing sin. But because God is tolerant, he's very kind. Now we see everyone's talking about the love of God. But where you speak about holiness and the seriousness of sin, people are getting a bit annoyed and irritated. What we find is, this re-image God is an all-embracing God. His love is an all-embracing love. Thirdly, the re-image God, he has different standards. He has a certain standard for the young adults, and he has a different standard for the young people. Whereas in Bible days, God remained unchanging, and if people wanted to approach God, they had to change. If we want to approach God, we change. But in the present trend is to change God, to customize God, to edit, to amend God, so that he suits us. There's no question of our being changed. Now, what do we find amongst many young people? They are not changing. Rules are changing. Standards are changing. So many things are changing to adjust everything for the young people to make them happy. Who's become the center? The young people have become the center. The devil does not want God to be in the center. He wants anyone else to take that place. In fact, he wants you to take that place. The re-imaged God is no longer the one who does not change his standards. Now, the re-imaged God keeps changing from time to time. He suits the times. Also, the re-imaged God does not seek single-minded devotion. That is, you can, while you're worshiping him, now real, the original true Bible God, he wants us to enjoy him, to love him, to serve him. It's all him. But the re-imaged God, he says, now I'm not all that particular that you should be enjoying me only. Now while you're enjoying me, you can enjoy your music and you can enjoy everything around you. And you can enjoy me as well. It's not just me all the time. He permits that. You see, because this re-image God is so concerned about how we must enjoy ourselves, today people, when they are worshiping God, they have lost that image of God, the true image. Now, who we worship is no longer important. How we worship has become important. Can you imagine preparing for, say, the Easter service or the carol service? And a group of singers come onto the stage. Now, I'm telling you, much of what I'm going to share today are all from my own mistakes. Much of practice is put in, and preparation, and 1 or 2 months of practice, and so much goes into it, and now they are on stage. Tell me, these singers are so conscious of how they perform. The musicians are all ready to see how they perform and how they present themselves to the people. And do I look beautiful enough? Is my hair all right? Everything, all that is there. And they sing. And when they finish singing, we see they have performed. They have done a good job of singing. Where is God? Whom they are singing to, that one is forgotten. How they are singing has become more important. When we forget whom we worship, then how we worship becomes more important. Whom we worship is very, very, very important. Now I'm going to devote the rest of the session to the desecration of worship through music and singing. Now I'm going to speak a lot about myself and see all through my own mistakes how I have learned. The devil has harmed many churches through the ministry of music and singing. And I want to tell you about this as time permits us. But let me begin by a statement made by one Ron Owens. This man is a speaker, a songwriter, and a musician. In his book, Return to Worship, he remarks, "Looking back across the history of the church, very often, the music of that particular church would tell us the spiritual state of that church. When the church was backsliding or in a period of apostasy, immediately it would turn to drama and entertainment." Now, this is Ron Owens. I don't even know who he is. He doesn't belong to our church at all. But he said, looking across history, when a church went down in its standard, immediately the music was affected and the church would go to drama and entertainment. But when the church turned back to God, preaching was restored to its rightful place, and that return was immediately reflected in its music. That church which came back to God was full of revived people, and revived people never want to be entertained. Can you believe that? Now, music. There's no music without musicians. Am I right, Brother Benzi? There's no music without musicians. Right? Now, the use of music, is it scriptural or unscriptural? It is very much scriptural. We find cymbals and trumpets and harps and organs and other instruments were used. But we see God, that is the real one, not the re-imaged one, he placed very high demands on the people regarding the standard of the musicians. Musicians, according to the Bible, had to be Levites. Levites were ordained for the ministry. Do you know when the Levites were ordained? In which part of Egypt were they ordained? Goshen or Ramses? Which part of Egypt were the Levites ordained for the ministry? They lived in Goshen. So were they ordained in Goshen then? Then? They were ordained only after they left Egypt and came to the foot of Mount Sinai. Only there the Levites were ordained. Let me tell you, no musician can be in Egypt. Basically, God wants a musician has to have left Egypt, taken water baptism, saved, water baptized, received the Holy Spirit, come to the foot of Mount Sinai. Being a Levite, you can find the references in your syllabus. The musicians or these Levites were consecrated, they were commissioned, they were appointed to specific ministries, they were clean, they were pure, they were mature, they were spiritual as well as skillful, they were dedicated. All these excellent qualities, the original, the living true God demanded from musicians. The reimaged God is a little kinder. He waits for the musician to leave Egypt. When musicians and their music are under the control of God, then the Holy Spirit can use the ministry of music to soften, comfort, and calm people's hearts. Unfortunately, in many churches, perhaps in our church, I will leave that to God to decide and tell us, music is used to worship God, and if music goes out of balance, suddenly we see the original sin committed. What is the original sin? The angel thought, why must he alone be the center? Why can't something else become the center? Worship means feeling in the heart towards the object of worship. Now what is happening? Music has become God. Why? We use music to worship God. Suddenly we begin to worship the music instead of worshiping God. We begin to enjoy the music more than enjoying God. We can see music has taken the center. Immediately you know that angel is somewhere. The angel is somewhere. I want to tell you, those of you who are involved in music, this is going to be helpful, but for the whole church, everyone must be aware of the danger that music poses. It can cause more damage, according to Christians and music leaders and saints outside our church. They have said that music has caused more damage in the life of the church than almost anything else. Why? Now I'm going to speak not as a musician, but as a guilty musician. I have sinned in all the areas that I'm going to mention. First of all, egoism and self-image. Image plays a very important role in the life of a musician. The very nature of music and the temperaments that often accompany those gifted in music makes music the womb for growing egos. There's this ego problem, and that immediately gives the spirit of competitiveness and jealousy. There's always that problem. This music ministry has been dubbed by someone as the war department of a church. And another person remarked that when Satan was cast out of heaven, he landed in the choir loft. Now these are remarks by people, but it is true. The reason music is so powerful, it can take the place of God. Now I have played music, and played music while people are singing, I've played. And I've enjoyed my playing and enjoyed my music, and I know I've made people enjoy my music, and everybody, they were responding to the music. How were they responding? Clapping, singing, dancing, jumping. It all looked like they were worshiping God. But who's the center there? The music, the musician. So I did what the angel did. I became the center. You see, the angel says, carry on your singing, but let not God be the center. Let the music become the center. Let the musician become the center. Secondly, operation in the flesh. Music has the potential of operating more in the flesh than in the spirit. Let me tell you, very often What is the mistake musicians do? They use God to exalt their own talents, then use their talents to exalt God. We use the name of Jesus, everything, to exalt our own talents, instead of using our talents to exalt God, and very often they can't even make out the difference. What do musicians do very often? I speak as a musician. I don't know about any other musician. When I say musician, I speak of myself as one who has played and made the mistake. I have played so that people would respond to the music, or they would admire my music. What was I doing? Where they should be worshipping God, I was taking their minds away from God and bringing them to me. What was I doing? Diverting. What are the musicians doing? Entertaining. Instead of ministering, they are entertaining. That angel is somewhere. Thirdly, domination. According to the Bible, singing is more important than music. That's the order. Does anyone know the reference? First come the singers and after that the musicians. Can you tell me where in the Bible do we find that? Come on. 1 point. Psalm 68, verse 25. Psalm 68, 25. You see, this is God's procession. The singers went before, the players came behind. This is God's order. But very often, accompanying instruments are louder than the singing. This is something I have done. Perhaps I still do. But you know, this tends to discourage the singers, not to encourage them. And it distracts the worshippers of God. Musical accompaniment is meant to be just that, accompaniment. Fourthly, now I do not know about anyone else, but again in my own life, musicians find this music is a non-negotiable area. That is, you can never ever convince a musician about his music. Musicians tend to feel that most non-musicians do not understand them, and consequently they have no say in the matter of music. They meet that whole challenge with a closed mind, and they will defend their music to death. I still remember the day when a brother, he was a spiritual brother, he came up to me and he said, I like it when you play. You know, when you play it's nice. But you know, when Brother Emmanuel plays the keyboard, I really feel the presence of God. And I just did not like that. I said, what do you mean? He said, brother, you play well. But when Brother Emmanuel plays, I can just feel God coming down. I said, now look here. For every song, I play a minimum of 15 to 20 chords. But the Emmanuel plays only 3 chords, and invariably they are wrong. It's because you don't know music that you feel what you feel. But I know music, and I know he's messing up the music all the time. He's spoiling it all the time. We are not able to enjoy it when he plays. So he said, brother, I know your chords are good. I'm not a musician, so I don't understand them. But when Brother Emmanuel plays, I feel the presence of God. I said, look here, please, let me tell you something. It's true, but how can you, who are non-musician, decide these things? I don't think you can pass any comment on this. You have to be a musician to speak about it. So he said, brother, I'm not a musician. But one thing, let me tell you, he told me. When Brother Emmanuel plays, I feel the presence of God. And when you play, I feel nothing. And he ran away. His name was Stephen. I tell you, he would have been a martyr had he stood there. He could not convince me. I tell you, I was a proud musician and I still am. It's a dangerous area. Musicians find that music is a non-negotiable area. They will defend it because they feel others can't understand them. Said Peter Masters, pastor of Spurgeon's Metropolitan Tabernacle in London, he said, England is 20 years ahead of America in spiritual decline, and the first thing to go in the churches was the music. Now, I want to tell you about the language and the power of music. Many people say music is amoral, that is, it's neutral. It only adds emphasis to the words, but I want to tell you it's not always true. Very often, music is a statement in itself. And listen to the statements made by some of the great musicians in the past. Even in the 1600s, one composer, he asserted, he was a great composer, a great name. He asserted, the end of all music is to affect the soul. Plato once said, music is a more potent instrument than any other for education. With Baroque music behind, playing in the background, children are said to study much better. Music does affect education. The Scottish poet Carlyle is purported to have said this, let me make a nation's music, and I don't care who makes her laws, I will control that nation. And Aristotle made this statement, music directly imitates the passions of the soul. So when one person listens to ignoble or bad music that imitates a certain bad passion, the person, he becomes imbued with that bad passion. So if the music comes from a bad source, there is a certain passion that goes with that music. Although music, we think it's amoral, it's neutral, it won't affect you, there is a certain passion that comes with that. And as you enjoy that music, that particular character, that bad passion, it sticks to your soul. Now, the language power of music, I want to tell you, first of all, music can cancel out the words of a song. Now, I know, how many of you are musicians here? Musicians, I know one. And clap your hands. Okay. Alright. So I will remove the technical stuff from here. I will make it very simple for the common man to understand. Now, singing. What is singing? How do you define singing? Singing is the utterance of musical sounds. A song. Now we've been singing songs. A song has melody. How many of you know what melody is? Okay, a song has melody, harmony, and rhythm. These three go with a song. Now let me just demonstrate what a melody is. You tell me what that song is. Brother Tony just told me he doesn't know anything about melody. When I asked you what the song is, immediately, you didn't tell me Land of Pure Repose. You started singing the song. You know why? Do you know why you did that? Because the melody of the song is called, that's the melody, the tune. The melody of the song is called the face of the song, or the profile of the song. You recognize a person by the face. You recognize a song by the melody. Anyone who composes a song knows that the words of a song, they are always attached only to the melody. So, when a song is sung, immediately the words are remembered. Now, for example, if you want to memorize a piece of scripture, attach it to a tune. You will always remember the words. So, words and melody always go together. And so, when you sing a melody, what happens? The words begin to edify the singer, provided the words are scripturally sound. That the words of a song, do you know which part of you? Now, Brother Tony is body, soul, and spirit. The words of a song, which part of you is edified by the words of the song? The spirit of a person is edified. I will tell you why. The Bible says it is the spirit that seeks God, and the words are attached to the melody. The moment the word is sung unto God, the person is edified. That is why we read spiritual songs. The Bible says, sing spiritual songs. Spiritual songs are songs when you sing them, you are edified. That is, the words immediately lift you up towards God. How many of you have sung a song and you feel you are lifted up to God while you are singing? How many of you have felt, sometimes when I'm singing, I find I'm singing, but I find there's a battle. I sing the words, but I'm struggling to actually sing unto God. Let me carry on to tell you why. Why do we struggle with many of our songs? Second part of the song is harmony. Brother Tony, do you know what harmony is? Now, what you heard was melody. Now, this is melody. Now, what is going along with that is melody. In a well-written piece of music, the melody will be there, but it will always be softer. It will play a subservient role. It will not dominate. What is melody? Melody and accompaniment. Now, you have some extra things also. Now, for example, you have the harmony. You can have some accompaniment. Okay? Now, that's little accompaniment. When you hear that, it sounds a little better, doesn't it? Than just the tune. This sounds a little better. What happens actually? Harmony adds to the beauty. Harmony adds to the beauty of a song. Do you know which part of the human being is affected by harmony and the accompaniment? The soul of a person. The soul of a person is harmony primarily appeals to the soul of a person. So the soul and the spirit both join together. Provided the melody is dominating, the words are powerful, and the harmony is kept in its place, the soul and the spirit are both lifted up to God. But sometimes the harmony and the accompaniment becomes more rich than it has to be. I remember so many times I made people learn a song in about 10 minutes. Then I spent about few days in working out the harmony. And the people did their ha 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 and all that. And it became a wonderful performance. When the accompaniment and the harmony and all that becomes very rich, the primary appeal becomes to the soul and not to the spirit. The worshipper is struggling to worship God, but instead, because the appeal is to the soul, he is distracted and confused and struggles between his spirit's worship of God and his soul's admiration of the music. So often we admire the music and it makes us struggle. That becomes soulish music. So, that is soulish. Most of the young people, they love music like that. Definitely, soulish music will be far more beautiful than spiritual songs and music. But we must ask, is it serving purpose for which it is written? Now, thirdly, rhythm. Let me tell you, this is all for the common man. I'm not going to define rhythm, but there's rhythm in everything. There's rhythm in waves. There's rhythm in the cycles of night and day. There are rhythms in your body. Everything is by rhythm. And there's a song without rhythm is dead. Now, what is rhythm? Now, rhythm is the orderly movement of sound. What happens? Which part of the human being is affected by the rhythm? It's the body. Because the body has rhythm built into it. There's rhythm in heartbeat. There's rhythm in every cell. There is rhythm. So, what happens when the rhythm dominates? Immediately, it's the body that responds. If the melody and the words dominate, the spirit responds to God. If the harmony dominates, the soul responds in admiring the music and enjoying the song. If the rhythm dominates, instantly the body responds. How you feel like tapping, clapping, swinging. How many of you have responded to a song? It's a simple song. You know, though here the road be rough and steep, a bit boring. But when there is harmony, oh, it's nice. It's nice. But do you feel your body affected? When? You see? All the sleeping saints are waking up in a twinkling. You see? The body is responding. It's a glory there. You see, the body dances and moves. What's happening? Body is responding to the music. Soul is responding to the accompaniment. And the spirit is saying, though here the road be rough and steep and bitter trials may make us weep. Bitter trials may make us weep. You see, the whole thing is such a confused thing. You see, most of our songs are confusing us. Songs and choruses that have a driving beat and are constantly repeated, they are found to have a profound impact on the human body, especially on the level of adrenaline. The level of adrenaline in the human body can be affected if the song and the chorus have a driving beat and is constantly repeated. In fact, it can stir up an entire congregation into an emotional frenzy. And this is the root behind many worship sessions in many churches, behind the revival. Special care must be therefore taken to ensure that the people are not being emotionally driven into a high, either by the drums or the bass guitar or a charismatic worship leader. I have seen and I have also tested out the emotions of people. I have sinned in the congregation of the children of God with my bass guitar. I found that when I stopped this accompaniment, the rhythm with the bass, I found that the people mellowed down in their worship. And then when I brought it back again, immediately I could see their body moving. What do they think? There is an anointing in the song. Is it really in the an anointing, or is it the adrenaline? You must think. You know, when we say, I worship you. Can you do that? You can't do that so much. But the moment you have a fast song with a driving beat, immediately the body responds. The body is responding not to God. Worship of God is responding to God. When the body responds to the music, the body is worshiping the music. The soul is responding to the harmony, the spirit. Oh, we are torn apart. So we can see what's happening. In fact, a research was established that rhythm patterns greatly affect the human body. One Dr. John Diamond, he was a primary researcher in this area. He conducted experiments in what is called behavioral kinesiology, and he discovered that rhythm patterns can actually weaken the human body by decreasing muscle strength and making the music addictive to the listener. What happens? The heart and the blood have what is called first beat rhythms. Any beat that is opposite of it biologically will trigger off some warning message in the body that something is going wrong, and you may not know of it. The body will respond to that rhythm with muscle weakness, anxiety, aggression, and strangely, you start craving for more of that beat. The Insight magazine reported on its science page that discordant sounds hurt learning and alter the brain tissue. One composer, he decided he was going to create chaos. The original performance of his work is Igor Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. What happened when that was performed? It resulted in a massive riot and the destruction of the entire concert hall. That is the power of music. Now, in the early days, there was rock music which people were attracted by. But I want to tell you, the bottom line of rock music is the rhythm and the volume, and it was designed to symbolize the rebelliousness of the youth. And it is said that music with excessive repetition of a melodic phrase, repeat, 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 quite often, even in a meeting, we keep on repeating, 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 repeating. And many people have questioned, why do we go on doing that? Then there is a dominant beat. Thirdly, there is intense volume. These are the basic three ingredients of rock music. So even though we have gone off that rock music, we could be subtly allowing it to stage a comeback. So that's the effect of music. Soulish music, spiritual music, and sensual music. The music which affects the body is called sensual music. Now, we can see the devil has affected this area of worship, music. Music can take God away from the center. Therefore, may God help us to keep God back in the center. Then, singing. Now, how about singing? Does God love singing? God loves singing. The Bible says we must come into His presence with singing. Does the Bible say that God sang a song? He will rejoice over thee with singing. The Bible records that Jesus sang a hymn. So we can see singing is part of God. And the Holy Spirit singing unto ourselves with psalms and hymns. It's the ministry of the Holy Spirit. The triune God loves singing. Now, Satan has come into the singing. Which are the areas that he wants to affect? First of all, I want to tell you about the words or the text of a song. In a song, two things are required about the text. One, the words, the text, it must be very honest and straightforward. The meaning should not be ambiguous or confused, and it should be based on correct doctrine and scripture. But we find so many songs have been this law has been violated. There is now this humanistic philosophy. I told you, humanism places you in the center. Today we must ask ourselves, how many popular Christian songs, which many people love and sing, have taken God away from the center and placed man in the center? People now are singing, I am blessed, I am happy, I am nice, I am good, I. Many songs which said, God, you are worthy, holy art thou, oh worship the king. Those songs are moving out, and many I. Remember, Lucifer said I, and Jesus said not I. We can see humanism has affected the words of many of the modern songs. And then we have what is called crossover songs. Now, let me just show you.
My life is death. I can feel your touch. I can feel your breath. I want to be close to you. I love you so much. Without you, my life is death. I can feel your touch. I can feel your breath. I want to be close to you.
I love you so much. Without you, my life is death. I can feel your touch. I can feel your breath. I want to be close to you. Shall we all stand and sing this song? Shall we all stand? Why? This is not a Christian song at all. This is not a Christian song at all. It's a song a man sang to his lover. But doesn't it remind you so much of the songs? A.W. Tozer, a man of God in the 60s, he died. He said, many of our popular songs and choruses in praise of Christ are very hollow and unconvincing. Some are even shocking in their amorous endearments. He says it's so full of love, 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 we don't even know to whom it is being sung. Romantic love. Because the divine and pure love of God is brought down to the level of carnal, romantic, human love. This is the second mistake in singing, in the words, in the text of the, that is the words of a song. Thirdly, many of the modern songs overemphasize the humanity of Christ, that is, Jesus being a man. This is a big, big problem. You know, when a sinner comes to sing a song, he should not be able to sing our songs, because very often today, the sinner gets to love God even before he's convicted of his sins. A sinner doesn't tremble before the holy God. Before he can tremble thinking of his sins, he's introduced to his great big daddy in heaven, waiting just to pour out his love upon him. Before they are broken at the cross, they become part of the great big family. This is the new gospel with the new cross and the re-imaged Christ. Now, for example, take this song. He is one of us. Oh yeah, he is one of us. He's right here. Why do you fear? He's just part of us. It also sounds. Yeah, he's among us. He's one of us. These are all words of songs. But what are they doing? They are bringing God right down, humanizing him. And it sounds so comforting. He's one of us. Such songs are full of happy themes, making you very light and carefree. It will never make you holy. A man of God said, reverence and awe have been replaced by familiarity, and the consuming fire has been domesticated into a candle flame. The violation of this law has brought about rock operas like Jesus Christ Superstar and blasphemous commercial movies like The Last Temptation of Christ. This is a second problem with the text. Thirdly, the death of the hymn. In early days, do you know why hymns were composed? Hymns were composed mainly for the teaching of the doctrine. Martin Luther began writing hymns so that his doctrine would be remembered by the people. In fact, the Bible does support singing of hymns. Hymns have endured many years because they are rooted in deep doctrine, with Jesus as a central theme. It is from the deepest root that we get the deepest nourishment. But today we find many leaders, in their zeal to minister to the modern generation, they have decided to cut off hymns, and instead they are feeding especially the young people with mini bites of song literature. How many of you know Isaac Watts? If you don't know Isaac Watts, I'm sure you will not know his 875 hymns. You may not know Charles Wesley and his thousands of hymns, which were used by God to bring about the great awakening that saved England from the French Revolution. I believe the next generation, if the present trend continues, will never sing When I Survey or Oh for a Thousand Tongues. Hymns are being cut off. Thirdly, how is the devil work to defile songs, the songwriters themselves? Many hymns in the past were written by ministers. Isaac Watts, John Newton, Charles Wesley were all ministers. Their texts were all based on the Bible, and doctrinally they were sound. Most songwriters in the past were godly people, and they were rich in spiritual experiences, and they wrote from their experience. But today, almost anyone can write a song, as there seems no longer to be the need to write from experience. And there's no need for rhyme either. Songs can be written in seconds. Just write a chorus. Oh Jesus, you are wonderful. Oh Jesus, you are lovely. Oh Jesus, I do love you. Oh Jesus, I want to worship you. That's it. You got a song. Now what really takes time is the music, the accompaniment, and to make it sound really beautiful. Words, you can do it in seconds. Now this is how the balance has been changed. And you find much songs are written on demand, because there's a demand to produce songs, and they're not written from experience. Many CDs that are being produced are sold outside the Christian bookstore. And that is what is placing the demand on the people. And the image on the CDs, we see the image of the singers and the musicians. Whereas God said, do not make an image of me. How can worship people have their image on their cover? So we see this is the story behind their songs. And the fallen angel must be in stitches, because he's got God out of the center and he has put man in the center. Fourthly, songs and their singing styles. Many are borrowing styles from the world. Why? They're doing it on the grounds that it helps communicate the gospel more easily to the world. If I want to invite my worldly friends in, instead of singing, holy, 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 hey, come back, don't run away, I want them to feel more welcome. So let me sing it in a worldly style. Let me borrow some singing styles, the way they sing in, you know, worldly singers, how they sing. It will help communicate the gospel more easily. Now that's the argument. On the other hand, it actually causes total confusion, because the feeling, now this is from observation, the feeling that people get is, Christianity is not so hard as I thought. Beautiful and old hymns are now skewed to give it a contemporary rhythm pattern, says a songwriter. But very often, I told you, the words of a song have to go with the melody of the song. When you're singing, God, you are holy. Now say, Jehovah, you are holy, and I love to worship you. You can see the words go along with the tune. But to, if you think it's old-fashioned and you want to give it a little contemporary style, what do you do? Well, that's the accompaniment. But how do you give it this modern thing? Instead of singing, Jehovah, you are holy, and I long to worship you. And sing, Jehovah, you are holy, and I long to worship you. Oh, you see, what's really happening? You're singing, you are holy. The words are the same, but it doesn't match the tune. Again, there is confusion. Singing styles can bring confusion. Fifthly, performance. Everywhere in the Bible we are told to sing unto the Lord. But now what has happened? Singing has become an art form, and a song is treated as an art form. Therefore, the stage is used to exhibit human talent. This again makes tells us that God is no longer the center. Today, singers hardly sing. You know, when a singer comes up to the stage, who is his audience? If he's singing unto the Lord is his audience. But so often, you know, when singers come up on the stage, they're singing for the people. The people are the audience, and the singer becomes the takes the center stage, and the people are watching the singer. And they are enjoying the style of singing, the music and everything. And at the end, when we applaud at the end, it gives glory to man, not to God. And what does a singer feel? It feels that I sang well. The singer immediately has the feeling it was a performance. It is not God, but the self that is exalted. I tell you, a person who's singing unto God, it's no difference. Different from a person who's praying unto the Lord. Have you ever heard, in Jesus' name, Amen? A beautiful prayer, brother. That was a lovely prayer. Have you ever done that? Then why should we applaud for a song? Or tell a person they sang well, or you prayed well? It becomes a performance. I know I have prayed in public, and I'm more conscious of the eloquence of my words than the person unto whom I am praying. The Bible makes it clear from the incense in the Old Testament. God said, when you offer incense unto me, do not add perfume to it for man to smell. If a man smells, he will die. Incense is worship. He says, don't add smell to it, because God wanted everything to come directly to him, not to make it beautiful for people to appreciate. Sixthly, pretending. Many times, people use their talent to mimic godly preachers and godly singers. Now, godly preachers. I remember one day, an elderly mother, we went to visit her and she said, come, watch this man preaching. And I was watching this man. She was watching this God Channel program and I was watching this man. He looked like Jesus, whom the artists represent as Jesus. Long hair. And this man, he was saying, I have a message and I want you all to understand. And I said, he is an anointed Jeremiah, because he looked anointed. The way he was speaking was anointed. You know, if you speak like some of our pastors, shall we open our Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 7? Shall we read this verse? Shall we read that verse? Okay. What do we read here? What will happen? Brother Benzi will go to sleep, isn't it? But instead, if the preacher is animated, shall we look? He does all these things. When you see that, you think he's under the anointing. Am I right? Well, this man was doing all that. He was sweating. He didn't have tissue. He had a huge towel there. And he was using this towel to wipe his hair, wipe his face. And he said, I have a message for you all. I have a message from the Lord for you all. I can see billionaires sitting in the hall. I can see billionaires here. Hallelujah! And the whole crowd started jumping and cheering. Billionaires, billionaires, billionaires. And he went on. And then he started something. I had a shock. He said, the Lord is going to make you rich. You believe that? Now say, the Lord is making me, the Lord is making me rich, the Lord is making me rich, the Lord is making me rich. And then these mini skirt women, they stood up and they sang, the Lord is making me rich, the Lord is making me rich, the Lord. And I was wondering, what is happening? But I'm telling you, what was this man doing? He looked and he sounded fully anointed. Pretending. Preachers can pretend, so also can singers pretend. The body language is easy once you practice it. It's so easy. Forgive me, and may God forgive me if I'm doing something wrong, but I'm going to pretend. Now, I'm not going to think about the Lord. I'm just going to think the time is 3:40. I'm 10 minutes late and the people are ready to stone me. Yet because I have to sing a song, I'm singing. But let's look at the spiritual look on my face. I love you, Lord. You see the eyes? Love you, Lord. And then, I love you, Lord. The hands, the body sways gently, rocks. All this is body language. The entire congregation, you do, I love you, Lord. I wonder what they're going to serve for tea. The same hands, same hand. And who will win the quiz? The hand is moving, the spiritual face is maintained, everything goes on. Body language. We give the impression we are under the anointing. Sincere members of the congregation, they mistake all this for the power of the Holy Spirit. We can clap, we can jump, and I tell you especially, a problem of those who often come up on stage, I'll tell you, they want the crowd to respond. They want crowd response. They will do anything, even pretend. But all this is stage acting. All this is performing. No longer do we see God. Now we are seeing talent. Talent has replaced the anointing. Real worshiping saints like Frederick Faber, singers and preachers in the past, who were really struck down by the anointing in their ministry, they are missing. Now pretending, pretending, pretending. Those who do not have the anointing in that ministry, they should sincerely and modestly accept that they don't have it instead of pretending. In fact, when we pretend, we will never really get the real experience. And finally, the seventh point, another way of, you know, where the singing and music ministry is affected. Basically, singing is singing unto God. But we can, as A.W. Tozer puts it, he says, there are some among us these days who have to depend upon truckloads of gadgets to get their religion going. What will they do when they don't have the help of the trappings and gadgets? The early church had hardly any sophistication. No gadgets. Ron Owens, he was praying and he was told that he has to lead the worship in one church. And it was a big, big church, a famous church. And he prayed prayerfully. He said, "Lord, I want to give you all the glory." And he went there. He expected to see one minister there, but he saw many ministers. One was the minister of singing, apart from the minister of preaching. Then there was the minister of music. Then there was minister of PA as well. And the minister of PA came up and said, "Ron Owens, I'm so and so. Now, I'd like to know, when you're singing, would you like the lights dimmed or would you like it bright? Can you leave the lights as it is? I don't need depend on the lights. And how would you like the musicians to be this way or that way and facing you this way?" Oh, the whole focus, you see, God is no longer the center. This man, Ron Owens, writes it in his book. So we can see how so in so many ways our music and our singing has been desecrated. Worship of God. Now, singing and music is not worship alone. It's only part of our worship. There is worship without music and without singing. In fact, our whole life is about worshiping God. "I love you, my Jesus." If someone can just stand up and say, "Jesus, I love you," and they mean it from their heart, that is worship. Sometimes you may not even say it. You may feel it in your heart and tears flow down. That is worship. But I could stand here and say, "I love the Lord. Amen." And you think, "Oh, that's wonderful." No, it's not wonderful at all. That's deception. So let us really defeat the desecration of Satan. How do we defeat the desecration of Satan? The desecration of worship is defeated by the consecration of worship. And that is the session 3. I will leave it to whoever's doing it to do it. But now we can see worship in churches all over the world has been desecrated when they welcome the great God entertainment. The church wants to be fed on excitement. Such a church is no New Testament church at all. For centuries, I'm reading from the writings of people, for centuries, churches had stood solidly against every form of worldly entertainment. But recently, many have given themselves over to this God of entertainment. Religious entertainment is crowding out the serious things of God. Drama has become important. Now, all this is Tozer. Many churches are running a poor second to the theater. Thank God when leaders obey God and fear only Him and not men. So, we have concluded session 2, where Satan wants to desecrate worship. How does he desecrate worship? By either taking God entirely out of the center or leaving Him there but changing our view of God. When our view of God is changed and He is the re-imaged God, our whole worship is affected. Dear children of God, let us be true worshippers of God. A true worshipper of God worships God and only God. That's the first commandment. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God only. Him only shalt thou serve. God must make us all true worshippers of God. Let's worship Him not only with our lips, but with our entire lives. Shall we stand? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time you gave us together. Lord, we've understood something more about worship, especially the ministry of music and singing as part of our worship unto you. And Lord, we just place ourselves in your will and we pray that the Holy Spirit may take over all our worship. Lord, we pray that we may not receive any worship. We pray that we may not seek any glory. But Lord, we may not even give glory to man. We want to give you the glory, and we want to be addicted to giving you glory. The world is addicted to entertainment and fun, but we want to be addicted to God. We want to be worshippers of God. We want to be sincere lovers of God. We want to have a passion for God. We want to adore God. Oh, like the saints of old, they bowed before you. They fell on their faces. They pressed their forehead to the ground. And they said, oh God, how dread, how beautiful, how glorious is your presence. Oh God, let mine eyes behold you. Oh Lord, they worshipped you, O God, in holiness, and they meant every word. But Lord, today we can see worship is desecrated. Help us, O Lord, to rebel and to resist. Lord, not to be part of it, but to be part of those who oppose it, O God. Not to oppose man, but to oppose that great God entertainment, the God of the world, who has been knocking at the doors of the church, O God, and knocking at the door of our heart. Help us, O Lord, to be addicted to you, to be lovers of you, and not lovers of entertainment. We give our lives, therefore, to you, that out of this life you may make a person who is a true worshipper of God. In Jesus' name we pray.